prison. You can actually sit down. Oh, sorry. Go ahead, sit down. I know you guys are ready. But before we start, we have something to show you first.
A celebration of
God, Jesus, Jesus dying on the cross.
God,
I have no idea.
Jesus getting crucified.
Easter,
I forgot.
When God died.
Easter.
Jesus coming back.
Easter. Jesus getting crucified.
What is Easter celebrating?
The Easter Bunny.
God.
I don't know.
What animal did Jesus ride going into Jerusalem?
A donkey.
On a donkey.
A goat.
A donkey.
I don't know that one either.
A donkey.
A donkey.
A goat.
The Romans gave Jesus a crown made of what?
Thorns.
I forgot
the plastic.
Thorns.
Who do you think would win the race? Bugs Bunny, Peter Rabbit, or the Easter Bunny?
The Easter Bunny.
You fast.
The Easter Bunny.
We're gonna go with Bugs Bunny.
Who is your favorite Bible character?
Jesus.
God.
I don't know.
Easter Bunny.
God.
Jesus.
Bunny.
Jesus.
Jesus.
The Easter Bunny.
Easter Bunny.
Why do we celebrate Good Friday?
The Last Supper?
Jesus died on the cross.
I don't know.
Jesus arose.
Jesus rise up from the grave.
Jesus was crucified.
What is your favorite thing about Easter?
All of the eggs and the chocolate.
Big memory.
Going on. Don't we get to find eggs and eat candy?
Candy.
Easter, the Easter eggs.
The Easter Bunny colors.
The golden eggs.
Eggs.
Easter eggs.
The leprechaun coming.
Eating the candy.
Easter eggs.
The toys.
Sometimes there's gold in the eggs and there's coins in them.
Easter bunny.
Everything.
A chocolate bunny.
The Easter eggs.
Chocolate bunnies.
Find the Easter bunny and find the egg with the inner bone now. You found the Easter bunny and wrap it. I just found an Easter bunny with egg to the favorite nut in the whole world.
All right, give it up for our kids at Hope. Thank you. Now you may stand. Thank you to Miss Jen and Miss Kara for putting that together. Have you come to praise the risen Lord this morning? I would think with a full room like this that we would be ready to answer. Have we come to praise the risen Lord today? All right, there we go. Do you see what I see? The Mary's got to the tomb. And the angel says to him, he is no longer here. But he invites them to come take a look for themselves. And I think when we read Bible stories, we're like, think it's all very holy. But I can only imagine as the Marys went in and they looked at the tomb and he was no longer there. They were like, are you seeing what I'm seeing? Wait, what? Do you see what I see? Apply this to your life. Do you see what God has done for you? Do you see what he has done for you? You were dead in your sin. But when you accept Jesus, you know are no longer in that tomb. Can I get an amen?
I don't know if we're awake today.
Come on, it's Easter, you guys. You guys had too much candy already. Father, we invite you into this place this morning, Lord, for us to declare that you have risen from the dead. You are no longer there. Lord, we sing your praises today because we know what you have provided for us. By dying on the cross and rising again, you fulfilled prophecy that said that you would do that. That means you're not a liar. You speak truth. So this morning we rejoice in that. We exalt your name in this place today. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray, and everyone said,
do you see what I see?
lost an earring. I felt something on my hand, and I was like, what is that? I thought it was a bug at first. Nope, just the back of my earring. Thank you for the cross. You made a way for us to come to you. And thank you for the cross. You made a way for us to come to you. Come on, sing it out today. Thank you. And thank you. And thank you for your son. And through you we have overcome. is he worthy of your praise this morning? Praise the Father. Praise the Son. Praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty. Praise forever. It wasn't just when people were saying, Hosanna to the King in the highest. It wasn't just in that moment. We get to praise him right now. Don't let today be a day that you just check off. Like, I went to church, now I get to go home and have my ham and mashed potatoes. Or whatever you're having. I'm not cooking, so it's a free-for-all at our house. Say, Lord, be intentional with your time this morning. As we go into this song, as we see a drama, as you hear the word, as we take communion. Say, Lord, prepare my heart for communion the rest of this service. Maybe that's, you're not going to sing. Maybe you're just going to worship. Just give him your praise, whatever that looks like this morning. He's worthy of it.
Shall not fade by his blood in it.
share with everyone said? Amen. Well, it's not hard to find someone to greet this morning. Tell them they look lovely or handsome or whatever, and say good morning to you.
Thank you. filled with his praises. One day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The word became flesh and the light shined among us, his glory revealed. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, and buried he carried me, my sins far away. Rising he justified, freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day they led him up Calvary's mountain. One day they die on a tree, suffering anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. Hands that heal nations stretched out on a tree and took the nails for me. Sins far away, rising he justified, freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day.
One day the grave could conceal him no longer. One day
All right. Thank you, Mike. Well, hey, good morning, everybody. Happy Easter. Happy Resurrection Sunday. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for choosing to join it with us at Hope Church. Nice to have the drama team back, you know. I'll be honest, though, drama just comes in church life. I don't know if you need a special team for it. But anyway, I'm glad we have it. And these guys are so in tune with each other. Would you believe it? Nobody called anybody on the team to say, hey, what are you wearing today? You see how much they just think alike. Anyway, and thank you, Joe Rutherford, for putting that all together. Thank you, guys. Ah, God is good. God is good. All the time. Thank you, Jesus, for... I just love this. I love these opportunities when we can all be together. And there's so many here. My goal today, friends, I'm going to get right to it and tell you what my goal is. My goal today, whether you have been serving God for 40, 50, 60 years, or you may not even be a Christian yet, my goal is the same across the board today. And that is simply this, that the cross of Jesus Christ and what the cross represents would be very, very clear in your life, maybe like it never has been before. And not only that, I know that's a tall order, but not only that, that the cross would be clear not just today. Because see, here's what happens. We think of the cross a lot the week of Easter. You know, Good Friday and Holy Week and leading up to Easter, we think about the cross. The cross is on our mind. But then if we're not careful, the cross gets blurry. The cross gets out of focus and we just don't remember what the cross represents. But my challenge today, and this is for me too, because as I was putting this together, I'm like, man, I need to hear this too. And I've been serving God a long time, is that the cross would not become blurry to you and what was represented on the cross. What am I speaking of specifically? Well, there's three things specifically that I really want to be clear in your life and mine today for Easter, sure, but every day. And that is simply these three things. Number one, when you look at that cross, that you see that beam that goes straight up and down, parallel, that beam represents that Jesus Christ died and rose again to make us in right standing with our Father. He paid that price. He paid a debt we couldn't pay. And when we see that middle beam, it represents what Jesus did to make me right with God as I put my faith in Him. Number two, that horizontal beam that you see going across, that represents that as believers, you know what we really are at the end of the day as believers? I'm just one beggar telling another beggar where the food is. Our responsibility as believers is we are ambassadors for Jesus in this world. And our goal is to not be hidden and hide our light under a bushel, but it's to go out and tell other people the good news. The Bible says the second commandment is as great as the first, to love your neighbor as yourself. And that cross, that middle beam represents my need to pour out to other people. And then lastly, the third thing, as you step back and you look at that cross, a cross ultimately represents death. It represents crucifixion. When I look at that cross, I need to remember that every day I no longer live. The Bible says I am crucified with Christ. If you're a believer, you're crucified with Christ. I no longer live. Jesus Christ now lives in me. It's the big three, I call it, you know. And so when you walk in the front door of our church, it doesn't take many steps in, my friends, until you see this big honking cross across the room. That's not there by accident. Travis Swash made that for us many years ago, and I love that cross. It's there intentionally. It wasn't like, you know, what are we going to put against this wall? I don't know, a cross. Hey, no, it's more than that. It's that we look at that and remind ourselves every day it's all about Jesus and what he did and what he allowed to happen. Now, you can be sure, my friends, if that is that important, that Satan will work overtime. I think he gets paid time and a half if you study it out. He works overtime to make the cross blurry in your sight. He don't want you focusing on what that cross represents. He wants that to be very, very blurry. But my goal today is whether you've been serving God a long, long time or you're still on the fence of this whole Christianity thing. You're uncomfortable right now saying, I don't know why I'm here, really. Somebody dragged me. They said they were going to breakfast, and here we are. But wherever you may stand, or those of you watching online, all my online friends, we have many friends sick that are home watching today. We miss you all. We love you. We're praying for you. But that this would be crystal clear today. So I'd like to open with a word of prayer, and we're going to get into it a little bit. Heavenly Father, thank you so much, Lord God. We celebrate not only what you did on the cross, but that you rose. You conquered death. You conquered sin. You made a way for us that nobody else could make, Lord Jesus. And I just thank you this morning. We just thank you, Lord, as we get into your word today. Man, I'm so honored and privileged to even have this privilege to speak to so many wonderful people about you, Lord God. You're my favorite topic. And to get to stand here and share you with others, Lord God, it just doesn't get better than that. So please help me get out of the way. Lord, I just pray that you'd open hearts and minds everywhere across this room and on the internet, Lord, as those watch today or later, that you would just open their hearts to hear your word. Help me, Lord God. I certainly can't do this without you. And I pray all this now in Jesus' name. Amen. So how exactly does the enemy try to block this, like try to cloud and make the cross blurry to us? How does he do that exactly? Because there's some things you better be sure he doesn't want you to know. Like, he does not want you to know about Romans 3:23. See, there's three verses, there's three sections of scripture in the book of Romans. They're called the Romans Road. The enemy does not want you to know these three. He wants to cloud those. He wants to block those. Romans 3:23 reads this. It says, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Everybody has come a little bit short, and not just a little bit, right? Not just a little bit. Everybody has come short. You know, I'll tell you something. Fun fact about me, and those of you who've been coming to Hope a while, you know this about me because I'm such an open book. I just tell you my life, whether you want to hear it or not. It kind of comes with being a preacher, I guess. I love me some documentaries. Any documentary fans out there? You guys get it. I watch documentaries of all kinds. I will watch documentaries on singers and different people that I don't even like just because I like documentaries, you know? I couldn't get through the Britney Spears one, though. I really did lose interest. I tried, but it's just not my thing. But maybe if you like her, that's fine. But, you know, I do like a wide variety. And I've noticed a common theme. When I watch documentaries on some of my bands from my era, like the 80s, any fans? You know, and even the 70s, I like some of the 70s music, too, and 70s and 80s. That's my era. I'll watch these rock band documentaries, you know? And you know what always baffles me? These guys will say things like, man, I was broke back then. I went bankrupt. And I'm thinking, how would you go bank? How were you broke? How did you go bankrupt, man? You like had hit songs on the radio and you're touring all over the world in these stadiums and you're broke. And I thought to myself, well, did they blow it all on mansions and cars and stuff? You would think maybe that. Nope. Believe it or not, that's not why they were broke usually. Or maybe you're thinking, did they spend it all on drugs? Nope, not even that. Although certain bands, if you just watch them, you think, man, they must have really invested a lot in drugs. I think of the Rolling Stones. I don't know how they do it. They toured 2 years ago, yet I think they all died 20 years ago. I don't know. That's a great trick. They just prop them up. Look alive. But I don't know how they do it. But that's not even it. You know what the common denominator seemed to be with a lot of these bands that didn't have any money in the heyday of their career? They all had a corrupt bookkeeper. They had a corrupt accountant who said, yeah, I'm paying your bills. Yeah, I got you covered. Yeah, we got plenty of money in the bank. They're not paying the taxes, and they're corrupt. And the next thing they know, these guys who think they have a full account, man, they're bankrupt. They're broke. See, the enemy does a similar trick with you. He doesn't want you looking at that cross and thinking, you know, yeah, I need what Jesus did. You know what he wants to tell you? Oh, there's plenty of goodness in your goodness account. You don't need what Jesus did. You know how much better you are than most people? You're way better than a lot of people. You're good enough. Your goodness account is full. You're good. You're in good shape. That Jesus stuff, and I used to believe this, that born-again Christians, like I used to think that's for people who are really messed up, you know? If you really did a lot of bad stuff in your life, maybe you killed people, robbed banks, you know, the good stuff like that, those people need Jesus. But the rest of us, we're good people, right? And he's like that corrupt bookkeeper to tell you, you got plenty in the account. You're a good person. You don't need the Jesus thing. Only to stand before the Lord one day and find out, I was bankrupt and I didn't even know it. I didn't have the goods. See, Romans 3:23 says, all have sinned. Another way of saying that, all are bankrupt before God. None of us have a good enough goodness account to stand before God and say, you didn't even need what my son did on the cross. Look at you, all on your own, so good. Nobody will have that story. Matter of fact, Romans 6:23, on our little Romans road journey, says that the wages of sin, that means the consequence of being bankrupt, in your goodness tank is hell. It's eternal separation from God. That's the consequence. You say, wait a minute. How did I become so bad all of a sudden? Well, here's the thing, friends. God is a just God, right? And when he created Adam and Eve, man, he created them perfect. And he said, I'm putting you in a perfect environment, and you have access to everything. Garden of Eden must have rocked, man. You know, it's been the coolest environment anywhere, you know. And they're walking around naked, just enjoying life. It was probably 85 degrees, I'm guessing. I don't know. Probably San Diego weather. And they're walking around, and then all of a sudden, they disobey the one command that God gave them. And the next thing we know, they bring sin into mankind. And friends, you might think you did nothing wrong. Why should you pay the price for what Adam and Eve did? Well, listen, when sin came in through mankind, it transferred from one generation to the next generation. And before you think, man, I'm going to beat up Adam when I see him, you would have messed up too, and so would have I. Because only God is perfect. So here we are. We have this dilemma. Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death. The enemy doesn't want you to know that. He wants the cross to be blurry and that you don't see any of that. And you know another lie he tells you? He says, you know what? It's different with you, though. God's going to give you a pass. He knows you're a good person. Maybe technically these are the rules, but don't worry. He likes you. When you get up there, he's going to say, all right, you get a pass. We're buddies. But it's kind of like that story that you may have heard with the judge and the man who got a speeding ticket. This guy got a speeding ticket, and he's friends with the judge of the town, so he went up to the judge and he said, hey, I got this speeding ticket, but you know, you're a judge. Can you, like, take care of this for me? And the judge says, yeah, give me the ticket. I'll take care of it for you. And so he took it. And then a couple days later, the man with the speeding ticket saw his friend, the judge. He said, I just want to tell you again, thank you. You know, thanks for making that ticket go away. He goes, oh, I didn't make it go away. I paid it for you. He goes, you paid it for me. I didn't expect you to pay it for me. I just, you know, you're a judge. I thought you could just kind of make it disappear. And the judge says, well, let me ask you, did you do the crime? Were you speeding? He said, well, yeah. He goes, well, then somebody had to pay. Somebody had to pay. My friends, we have two options. We dare to stand before a holy God on our own and say, you know what? I think I got enough to cover the bill. I think I got enough goodness that I don't necessarily need the Jesus thing. I'm just going to go it on my own. Or we can receive the most ultimate gift that anybody could give, right? Because the last part of that Romans road is Romans 10:9, which reads, because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. There's another verse that's similar to this. Listen to this transaction, right? We all like a good business transaction. You ever bought a house or a car? Lots of paperwork. Just when you think you're done, you're like, man, I'm signing my life away. Listen to this transaction. Listen close. Lean in. And ask yourself, have I filled out this transaction? Ephesians 1:13. In him, you also, when you heard the word of truth, starts with hearing, right? The gospel of your salvation, you heard about Jesus going to pay your price for you, and you believed in him, you were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit. You see how cool that is? When you get it, man, and here's the thing, we make things harder than they have to be. Friends, a lot of pastors put a lot of pressure on themselves at Easter. Man, I got to say things just right, and I got to go deep and this and that. You know what I've realized over the years? I get that. But if the Holy Spirit's drawing you or he's not, I don't want to get in the way of what God's doing. Because sometimes God will be speaking to somebody, and you'll think, man, I botched that up or whatever. And it's not about you. It's not about me. God wants you more than you ever would know. And God will find ways and draw you. And some of you might be sitting in this room or watching online thinking, yeah, I'm an on-the-fence kind of guy, you know, or kind of girl. I kind of believe, but I don't know. Listen, the Holy Spirit will draw you. But don't miss his drawing you, because, my friends, this is the biggest decision you will ever make. Who you marry, big decision. What your career is, big decision. Choosing to follow Jesus and taking this gift of him paying your debt, your sin debt, and setting you free of sin, that's something you don't want to mess up. That's something you don't want to miss. And my hope is as we speak, maybe the Holy Spirit's already drawing you and dealing with you. Now, let me say this, though. The cross can get blurry for the Christians. Let me talk to my Christian friends in the room. Because, you know, we get saved, it's all about grace, and it's all about what Jesus did, and we're so aware of the sinner that we are, right? But then somewhere, if we're not careful, the cross gets blurry, gets out of focus. And we buy into this lie that, well, I was saved by grace, but I got to maintain my salvation by my works. It was God's grace that got me in, but now I got to keep myself in the family. I got to work hard to perform for God so that I can keep my salvation, you see. And there's this lie that almost every Christian I know buys into. I've been there. Because, see, once you become a Christian, it doesn't take long till you realize something. Oh, I still got sinful desires from my old life. Oh, I still got a lot of that old me still hanging out, right? And then you start to realize I've got this wrestling match going up. And guess who's right there to cloud the cross? Satan. Satan likes to walk in right in those moments when you're a Christian, but then you blow it and you give into some sin. Maybe something from your past creeps up and you fall into something that you knew better. And guess who's right there to whisper to you? Satan's right there to say, I don't think you're really a Christian. You better get saved all over again. You better do this thing all over again, because a Christian wouldn't do that, right? And we can walk around condemned, like, oh, I got to try harder because God's not pleased with me. I spent the first probably several years of my Christian faith always feeling like this. And now maybe some of you can relate. I walked around feeling like God was always looking at me like, oh, this guy. What am I going to do with him? I'm going to kill him. I can't kill him. You're so close to being thrown. You know, I just thought that God was always mad, always upset with me. And they're like, I'm going to try harder, God. I'm going to try harder to make you proud of me and make you love me, right? And you just try so hard, and then you fail again, and Satan's right there to kick you. See? You don't have the goods. Check this out, friends. I want to free you for a second. I need the gospel of Jesus Christ on my best day. And I need the gospel of Jesus Christ on my worst day. Because guess what? On my best day, when my behavior is stellar and I'm doing everything right, my wife's probably thinking, I've been married to you 26 years. I'm waiting for that day. Yeah, hang in there. Me too. But on my best day, what? Yeah. No, you're perfect. Everybody knows that. Anyway, you think it would rub off on me after all these years. But on my best day, on my worst day, I need the gospel. But you see, the cross becomes blurry because all of a sudden we lose that middle beam is how we're right with Jesus. You know, if you think for a second, stand back, I'll take it from here, God, my righteousness is so good. Look at me. You're still so far on your own. But I know what you're thinking, right? Any healthy Christian should be thinking, well, yeah, but what about my sinful desires? And you're not just saying do that. No, let me show you what I am saying. I got such good news for you. Watch this, friends. This is good news. In Hebrews 8:10, it reads this. For this is the covenant that I will make with my house of Israel. This applies to you too, after those days, declares the Lord. Ready? I will put my laws into their minds, and I will write them on their hearts, and they will be their... I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Can I tell you why that's really good news? Check this out. Before you become a Christian, before you receive the gift of salvation and take the Holy Spirit into your life, guess what? You don't even know there is two natures in you. You're just one speed. I'm a sinner. This is what I do. I don't have any conviction. But you know how you know the Holy Spirit's moved in? Suddenly, you've got convictions. Suddenly, you're like, man, Never used to bother me when I did that sin, but now I'm bothered by that. Now I don't want to do that. Listen, the whole reason you even care when you fall into sin, the whole reason you even are convicted and concerned that you don't want to do those old things of your old nature, where do you think that came from? Do you think you concocted that on your own? God did that for you. God wrote a new desires on your heart. You didn't write them. See, Satan wants you to think you got to keep trying hard to muster up good deeds. No, without even trying, the Holy Spirit is writing new desires in you. Listen to this, my friends. This is freeing. Philippians 1:6. He who began a good work in you, who began it? He. It doesn't say you who began a good work in yourself. No, it says, he who began a good work in you will be faithful to complete it. The only reason you even desire to do good is because God put that in you. Because when the Holy Spirit moved in, new desires moved in. But guess what? We can connect with Paul the Apostle because he says this. In Romans 7:24, Paul says, wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? See, Paul was like, ugh, I'm this new creation in Christ, but I don't know if you get this, right? When you get saved, when you become a Christian, and I hope if you're not one, that you will be one. But when you become a believer, watch this. Your soul, your spirit is renewed. Born again, you're a new creation. God sees you as brand spanking new, clean, washed by the blood of Jesus. You're without sin. You are perfect before God. That's the only way you'd go to heaven anyway, because of Jesus. But your body is still hanging around. Your flesh, this old thing that's getting older, and the more mature, upright people, they lose their hair, and then some other people that are not as good, they still have it, whatever. But I mean, like, that's all part of getting older, right? This body, it breaks down, and this body still desires wrong things, but praise God that's not who Jesus sees when I... So what do I do? How do I deal with this? This is for my Christian friends right now. How do I deal with this sinful nature? Because I don't want to do those things, and neither do you, right? It begins with something else. You got to look at the cross. I want you to see that crucifixion in the cross. Listen to what Galatians 2:20 reads. It reads this, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Every day, my friends, you know what it begins with? I no longer live. I'm a new creation. So when Satan comes whispering to you and your flesh, your old nature says, hey, I want to go do all that stuff we used to do. Come on, all that sinful stuff. Come on, we don't do that. We got to do that. You got to remind your flesh, I'm a new creation now. God has done something new in me. You know what else it says in 1 Peter 2:24? You better believe Satan don't want you knowing this verse. He wants that cross cloudy and out of vision. Because listen what 1 Peter 2:24 says. He himself, speaking of Jesus, bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. Believe it or not, and this is a lie Satan wants you to buy, believe it or not, you've been given supernatural power to say no to the things you always said yes to. It's a secret, though. Satan don't want you to know that. He's like, are you kidding me? You're trapped, man. You have to do all the same stuff you always did. I saw a movie, Shawshank Redemption. Better see that movie edited. I think there's enough curse words in the first 15 minutes for 6 years. But anyway, but the plot is really good. You got to see it edited. But some of you, most of you, maybe many of you have seen it. But there's this scene in the movie that reminds me of what I'm talking about. The guy, Morgan Freeman, the part that he plays in that movie, he served 30 years in prison. And he finally gets out. And he gets a job at a grocery store as a bagger. And he has to go to the bathroom, and he says to the cashier, I gotta go to the bathroom, sir. Can I go to the bathroom? And he says to Morgan's character, you don't have to ask me every time you have to go to the bathroom. Just go to the bathroom. He says, well, I've been doing things the same way for 30 years, so I don't always know how to do anything different. See, that's the flesh. The flesh will try to say, what do you mean you don't want to sin? This is what we've been doing your whole life. But that's when you say, huh, but I'm a new creation now. The Holy Spirit now lives in me. Can I tell you something? If you're sitting here and you secretly wrestle, like, man, I never feel like I'm good enough. I always feel like God's mad at me. I always feel like just when I know better and I do that thing again, and doesn't God hate me? And am I still a Christian? And check this out, friends. I've watched this happen in my life, and I've watched it happen in many of your lives. As you keep looking at the cross, as you keep looking at Jesus, if you keep asking the Holy Spirit for help, because don't forget, when Jesus went to heaven, he sent us the Holy Spirit to live inside us. And the Holy Spirit, among other things, he's called our helper. Call on him. But watch this. As you call on him daily, you know what will happen? Your desire for the things of God will become greater for your desire for the things of the flesh. And the next thing you know, you're looking in your rearview mirror, and some of those fleshly things that you were just trapped in are further and further and further in the rearview mirror. You can't do it in your flesh, but the Holy Spirit has empowered you to live free. Can I get an amen this morning? I'm going to ask my wife would come up and play something, and the worship team as well. I do want to say just something here to my friends in the room and my friends watching online who maybe have never made that transaction, that business deal. It's a lot better than a business deal, obviously. But listen, my friends, if you haven't, you're still carrying all that debt. You may even still be buying into the lie. Then I got enough goodness in my account. I don't necessarily need to take the thing that Jesus did for me. Can I tell you something? If there was some other way that our sins could have been paid for other than Jesus having to be brutally tortured and suffer and pay that price, don't you think that Jesus wouldn't have went to the cross? If there was some other way. Jesus even prayed that, Father, if there's some other way we can accomplish this. But my friends, there wasn't. In a moment here, we're going to sing a song and pass out communion to you. Taking the bread and the cup is for those who are part of the family of God, who see their need for Jesus. You think your life's a mess? You think you've done too much that Jesus can't bring you into his family? Man, if you ever read the Bible, you'll meet a lot of messes. I mean, David was a hero in the Bible, and yet, adulterer, murderer. Moses, murderer. Paul the Apostle killed Christians. I haven't even killed anybody. I feel like I'm missing, like, I'm not as good as those guys. My point is this. You haven't done so much that you're without reach from Jesus. But on the other hand, your goodness on its own, friends, it's not enough. I love you enough to tell you, I don't want anybody standing before God one day saying, yeah, I had a good bookkeeper. He told me I had plenty in my account, so am I getting in? It's like, bro, you're bankrupt. You have nothing in your account. My friends, you don't know that you have tomorrow. You don't know that you have tonight. This is the biggest decision of your life. If you've never said, Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner, and I know that I don't have the goods on my own. I want to receive this gift of you dying for me and raising again and paying that debt of sin that I couldn't pay. And I'm a mess now, but I invite you to come into my life and start to change me and make me what you want me to be. Put that in your own words. But my friends, don't miss that opportunity. I will share this last verse and then we're going to sing. If you were anything like me in school, when it was report card time, I was always nervous. Did I do enough good things? Did I get enough good grades on my test? Am I going to pass? And then I'd get the report card, and I'm like, oh, so nervous. Am I repeating this grade? Passed. It was the greatest feeling. Yeah, I wasn't the greatest student. You don't have to feel that way about salvation, though. You don't have to sit here going, I sure hope my good deeds outweighed my bad. I don't think I did anything really bad. You have no idea, man. The standard's beyond any of us. But check this out. I will close with this verse. 1 John 5:13 reads this. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know. Everybody say no. That you may know that you have eternal life. You can walk out of here knowing, man, I settled this with God today. I settled this. My name's in that book. I made this right with God, and I told him I needed him, and I follow him, and I believe in him. And watch what he does with your mess. He'll clean you up. He'll do it in his time, in his way, and he will help you. I was at a church. I said I was going to close with that verse, but I was kidding. You like that joke? I'm going to close with this, though, this little story. I was at a church as a newer Christian, and a guy came and committed his life to Christ. And you know what one of the ushers did? And I didn't appreciate this. The usher reached into his pocket of this guy's shirt, pulled out a pack of cigarettes and crushed them and threw them away. He says, well, you won't be needing those anymore. It's not my job to come into your house and start cleaning, you know, all your stuff up. You receive Christ, you invite him in, and watch what the Holy Spirit does in your life. My job is to get out of the way of what the Holy Spirit's doing in your life and let him grow you and woo you and change you. He's the one who began that good work in you. You didn't even begin it. Will you receive him today? I sure hope you do. And if you ever want to come talk to me, I received him, now what? Friends, that's what I live for. We're going to go ahead and close with a song and get ready to take communion.
Just listen to these words. You can sing along with us if you want, but just listen to verse 1, verse 2, verse 3 have three different accounts. The first one is a leper. None would come close, but you wouldn't let go. Jesus sees him. Our second verse, it says, I had an issue and no one could help. But Jesus shows up. And the third one we have, I'm Mary, labeled by shame. Everyone sees my sin, but you called my name. See, the blood of Jesus wasn't just for the Bible. It applies to us today. So ask. Say, Lord, maybe you fall in one of those categories, or your category is completely different than any of those issues. Say, Lord, I need your blood today. Enough about a It says that Jesus went when he died on the cross. He wasn't just laying in a tomb dead. No, he had some work to do. It says that he went to the lowest hell. That means to the greatest of sin that would ever be committed. And he took that upon himself. So to answer your question, is the blood enough? Is it enough to cover my sin? The answer is yes. It's enough. Have we all been served? Took the bread and he gave thanks and he broke it and he gave it to them saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." As you take communion, let his blood wash over you. We're just going to see. that, yes, right now we've come before you. We've asked for forgiveness. And we know that you've washed over us. We didn't have to stand on our head or jump through any hoops in order for that to happen. But help us to remember as we go, we leave this place. Maybe by tonight we might need to ask for you to cover us again. Because we said something stupid. We've had anger within us. Some families are getting together that can get things riled up. Maybe it's with our spouse. Maybe it's with our children. Maybe it's not until we go into work tomorrow and we blow up. Lord, we don't have to have the cup and the bread in order to come before you and say, Father, I need you to cover me in your blood. I need you to wash me again. Those are symbols. But you made a way for us when you died on the cross that we can come to you any time we need to, which is probably all the time, and say, Father, here I am again. And the wonderful thing is we can come to you 1,000, 1,000,000 times, and you'll never look at us and say, oh, it's you again. I don't know if I have enough blood to cover you. No, it's enough. We pray blessings on every family represented in this place today and those that are online, that they would have a blessed Resurrection Sunday with their families or whatever is happening today, and that we would remember your great sacrifice for us, and that you have risen, and to walk as if you are alive. We love you, Father. In your precious name we pray, and everybody said, amen. Have a great day. We love you.